It started with 618. And then it went to 402. And then it went to 314. And then to 623. And then back to 314. And then back to 623. And finally to 317. I'm talking about my area codes of my life. Come on. Have you had different area codes in your life? Southern Illinois, hometown of Edwardsville, 618-656-2001. That was my number my whole life until I moved away to Seward, Nebraska for college, and I went from 618 to the 402. And then 402 was for 4 years, and then I went to the 314 of St. Louis, Missouri for the seminary for 2 years, and then for 1 year to the Phoenix, Arizona area in the 623. And then back for one more year at the seminary to the 314. And then back to Phoenix for the 623 for 2 more years. And then God called me here to the promised land of area code 317. Whew, that's a lot of area codes. But area code 317 is where God has called me. It is where He has placed me. And it is also where He has called you and where He has placed you. 317 is your area code. 317 is the Indianapolis area. And the mission that God has given to you and to me is to be who we are, where He has placed us, among the time, among the place, among the people where we find ourselves. Mission 317. Throughout this year, we're going to talk a little bit about Mission 317, and this is what I'm getting at. Everyone knows Mission 316. John chapter 3, verse 16, the gospel in a nutshell, the most succinct and sweet summary of the Christian faith known to humankind, the words of Jesus Himself, a mission for all of God's people, including His people in the 316 area code of Wichita, Kansas, but that's not us. John 3:16, maybe you remember it, for God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. The sweet, succinct summary of the faith that tells us that God loves so that He gave, and when we trust and believe, we live. And we want the world to know that. We want the world to know the sweetness of John 3:16, but we also can say we want the world to know the mission of 3:17. For the following verse, I believe, is just as sweet and can be pertinent for us as the people who live in area code 317. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Him. Mission 317, John 3:17, and it's amazing when you track through different 3:17 passages of the Bible that there's a lot that speaks about the nature of who God is, what He has done in Jesus Christ, how He sends us to be His people who believe in Him and live in Him and want to go out and share that life with other people. Mission 3:17. Why did Jesus say that part? For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Him. I think He knew the time and the place that we would live in. That many people who are in the world around us, even right here in our own area code, believe that the Church of Jesus Christ hates the world. That we hate the world, that we judge the world, that we're always pointing out the failures of the world. And I see where they get to that point. I go to movies, I watch what's on the silver screen. I stream stuff on Netflix. I watch the endless cycle of cable news. I listen to modern music. I know what times people say about the church. And they want to highlight a small segment of the Christian population that is always pointing out the failures of everybody else, pointing the finger, not in love, but in hatred towards everything and everyone else. And so it's no wonder that most people start to believe that. Even though I believe that that small little piece that is magnified on the silver screen or the streaming devices or on the radio or on the television is not representative of us as a whole. It takes a little bit of a small thing and it influences the thinking of a larger whole. All Christians do is hate. All Christians do is condemn. Christians hypocritically want to point out the evil in others but never take a look at themselves. And that's what we are up against in the world in which we live. And so it's no wonder that Jesus needed to tell us who we are in Him and what He has done for not just us, but the world. For God didn't send Jesus into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Him. That the mission of the gospel that we have been given is that Jesus Christ comes into this world to redeem it. To redeem the world means to buy it back. That it had been in the hands of someone who is not its rightful owner, Satan, sin, and death. But Jesus came to buy us back to God. That we are broken in sin and death. And Jesus came to restore us. That we need to be remade into the image and likeness of God through His Son. That Jesus came into this world to redeem not just us, but the whole world. And that is the mission that is before us in this new year. And that is the message that's before us on this, the Epiphany Sunday. On Epiphany, we are reminded that the promise of Jesus Christ is not just for Israel, but also for the Gentiles. Not just those people who are a small segment of the population who knew the words and promises of God, but for all people, both far away and near, that all people would come and be redeemed. It's the age-old promise of God's Word. A lot of times in the Christmas season, we read passages from the book of Isaiah. Isaiah was written more than 700 years before Jesus was even born. And yet people will tell you that Isaiah is so clear about who Christ is and what He would come to do that Isaiah can almost be read like a fifth gospel. But it's crazy that it was written all hundreds of years ahead of time. And Isaiah's promises a lot of times speak about the fallen people of God and how there will be a Savior, a Jewish Savior, who will come and restore them. And yet Isaiah also talks about the nations coming to the Lord. Isaiah chapter 60, verse 3 says, "Nations will come to your light and kings to the brightness of your dawn." Why will nations need to come into the light of the Messiah, the Savior of the world? It's because all nations have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That every member of the human family that is a descendant of Adam and Eve is under the curse of Adam and Eve. That is sinfulness in our lives. And so there needs to be restoration, not just for Israel, but for all of the world. And Isaiah said, Israel will be a light that will shine for the nations. Because the King of Israel, who will come through King David's line, will be the King of every nation. And nations will come to your light, O God, and other kings with a lowercase k will come to the brightness of your dawn. They will come before the capital K King, Jesus Christ. And so what Isaiah foretold hundreds of years before Christ had come, we then see the fulfillment of in the birth and in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So that that age-old promise of God's Word would bring about an ever-new plan. And so that ever-new plan is something that Paul talks about in Ephesians. And so in the book of Ephesians, Paul, as a Jewish Christian, is ministering to people who are both Jewish Christians and also Gentile Christians, both who are of Israel by nature and those who are from other nations. Maybe you've experimented lately with ancestry DNA tests. I don't know if you've done one of those yet. I did that last year, and this Christmas I gave some of those ancestry DNA kits to my mom and my dad. And so I called them the other day, and they were trying to take their gift out of their package and figure out what they needed to do. And my dad was trying to tell jokes and say, like, he didn't know what he was doing with it. And I said, "Dad, it's real simple." I said, "All you got to do is pull out the package. There's a plastic vial. You open it up. You spit in it till it reaches the line. You seal it back up, put in the envelope, and send it to the Mormons out in Utah because they're in charge of everyone's ancestry." He's like, "Oh, that's easy." He goes, I said, "Yeah, Dad, you know, I gave this to you in quite a bit of confidence that I, who have done the ancestry DNA, is going to be pretty similar to yours, Dad." And he's like, "Well, if it ain't similar, I guess your mom's got some explaining to do, isn't it?" Like, "I guess she does, Dad. I guess she does. But I'm counting on the fact that it's similar." But I was talking to a lady who cuts my hair a few weeks ago, and she has done these tests as well. And she let it be known to me that she is Jewish. She's not a practicing Jew, she made it be known, but she, in her ancestry, in her DNA, she's Jewish. And so to be Jewish is it not just a religion, but it is also actually means that you're from that corner of the world, that place in the world where Christ came. And now the Jewish people have scattered throughout the nations now, but still there is this idea that there is a Jewish nation, a people of Israel. And so Paul does something radical in his letters. He talks about how the fact that Jesus is an Israelite, but because he's both God and man at the same time, he brings together both those who are Jewish by nature and those who are non-Jewish, both the Israelites and the Gentiles, and he makes them one, people who are very different because of their backgrounds and the past and the color of their skin and their country of origin. He makes them one. How does he do that? Ephesians chapter 3 says this is the mystery. The mystery is that through the gospel, that is the good news of Christ's death and resurrection, that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel. That the Israelites had the promise of a Savior. They are the children of God, but now the Gentiles can be too. They're members together of one body, sharers together in the promise in Christ Jesus. That in their souls, they share something that is so deep and strong because it is nothing short of the love of God in Jesus Christ. And that that love of God in Jesus Christ merges them together in a way that they can never fully explain and never fully realize this side of heaven, but they are sharers together in the promise in Christ Jesus that those who were different now become one. And the Magi come. And the Magi come, and they were different. Some would say that the Magi were astrologers. They weren't reading the Old Testament prophets like the Jewish people were, but they were reading the stars. And they saw this massive star when it rose, and they followed the star that somehow and in some way they knew that a Messiah would come to Israel, but he would not only come to save the Jewish people, but everyone. And they followed the star, and they came to Jerusalem, and they started asking questions of the people they thought would be in the know, including King Herod. But King Herod was really no good king at all. He didn't even know his own scriptures as a Jewish king. He had to call in some of the authorities, and they said, well, of course, the Messiah is coming from Bethlehem. Micah said it. The prophet Micah said he's coming from Bethlehem. Though Bethlehem's small, not the least, but out of Bethlehem will come a ruler. And so King Herod says, hey, go check out Bethlehem. And if you find this kid, let me know, because I want to go and, wink, wink, worship him. He didn't want to worship the king. He wanted to cut the king's head off. He didn't need a rival. He didn't want someone who would threaten his power. He wanted to get rid of that threat. But the Magi went, and they followed the star. They listened not to the voice of some phony king, but the voice of God. And it says in Matthew chapter 2, verse 10, that when they saw the star coming to rest over the place where the child was, when they saw the star, they were overjoyed. The King James Version of the Bible says they were filled with exceedingly great joy. They were overjoyed because they got to see the star, because the star led them to the one who is the light of the world. And they now have a mission to be the sharers of that light when they would go back to their homeland by another route. When they would avoid King Herod and avoid the trap he was setting, and they would go back home, but they would go back home having been changed by him who is the light of the world. And I think that we saw a picture of that this Christmas season. That when we light candles like we did on Christmas Eve, the flame starts in Christ. That this final candle that was lit, the Christ candle that stands at the center of the wreath, is the candle that summarizes and symbolizes and sets before us the birth of Jesus bringing light into the darkness of the world. And that one candle gives light to another candle, and that candle in my hand gave light to another and to another and to another and to another. And then on a dark, still night on Christmas Eve, all of a sudden what once was darkness was filled with light. Because sharers together passed the flame of Christ to one another, and they shared the light that gives light to the world. That's mission 3:17. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, That is to let it just rot in darkness, but to save the world, to illuminate the world, to redeem the world through him. Some of you know this, others of you may not, that every year as the body of Christ, sharers together in Christ Jesus at Mount Olive, we set about to support work not only within our walls and what we do, but also outside of them. More than 10 years ago, your leadership as a church decided that what we would do collectively is what we seek to do individually. That when the scripture talks about a tithe being brought to God, that says that a great model for our faith is that 10% of our income would be dedicated as an offering back to God. That 10% would be a symbol of our whole lives being brought to God. And so I remember a leader in our church family at that time, more than 10 years ago, Keith Trimpe, who's now with Christ in glory, said, if it's good enough for us as individuals, shouldn't it be good enough for us as the church? And shouldn't we set the example? And so what we do is that with 10% of every offering dollar that comes in, it goes out. And so that the mission support is that as the love of Christ goes out into the world he died to save, our kingdom work extends beyond our walls to the world. And so we pray for these ministries and these service organizations that our dollars are supporting in this new year. So when you have 10% of our budget, which means this year will be more than $50,000, these 12 mission organizations are the start of how we want to take the gospel and get it out to the world Christ died to save. 12 is a good biblical number. 12 tribes of Israel, 12 disciples of Jesus, and here are 12 missions and service organizations. 7 of them are local. And we start with SAWS, Servants at Work, building ramps for the handicapped to get into their homes. Lutheran Child and Family Services, a shelter for at-risk children. Horizon House, a homeless day shelter to help our homeless neighbors rebuild their lives. Hope Center for Women, helping women who are escaping human trafficking. Pack Away Hunger, packing nutritious meals to bless people both here in food banks in Indianapolis and then sending some throughout the world. Calvary Lutheran School, where many of our kids grow in Christ. Lutheran High School, where many of our kids in Indy, both churched kids and unchurched kids, come to know Jesus Christ. And so you see there's 7 of them right there in our local 317 area code, but then you go beyond with the next 5. You go all the way to area code 314 in St. Louis, Missouri, and supporting pastors who are being trained at Concordia Seminary. You go all the way down to Chattanooga, Tennessee this year, where Pastor Josh Woodrow, who you will meet this winter, and Bridge City Community is bridging the racial divide that exists so strongly in portions of the South. Pastor David Michael Carrillo, we go even further to Latvia in his musicianary work of bringing music to come alive so Christ might be born anew in people's hearts. Calvary India Mission, supporting mainly the tailoring center where ladies are trained in their vocation to be seamstresses and to know the love of Jesus. And then as we celebrated over Christmas, Samaritan's Purse and Operation Christmas Child, those boxes filled with gifts of Christ's love throughout the world. So think about those 12 missions, and you can add to them different things that you do as individuals, that we say, this is who we are, but we are going to go and with the flame of Christ's love and share it. And I will tell you this, I have seen every single year that as we have deliberately done that as a church, 10% minimum goes out. God has always given us plenty within. He does that in my family. He does that with our church family. When you're faithful to God and his mission, he faithfully takes care of his own. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. Imagine that at the Hope Center. Some families among us know exactly what the Hope Center does because some of you have family members who have been there. That the mission of the Hope Center in Indianapolis is to be a Christ-centered residential campus committed to healing the personal and building the professional lives of women coming out of human trafficking. That they would see the light of coming out of that dark place, and when they saw the star and they see it's the light of Christ, that they would be filled with joy. They would be filled with joy because of the mission 317. How about Horizon House, a homeless day shelter in Indianapolis? What I'm so proud of, our connection with the Horizon House, is that it is by nature a secular organization. They receive support from churches, but also from the government and from a lot of non-religious organizations. But their CEO, Teresa Wessel, is a member of our congregation. And so we see Teresa and other people who are Christian people sharing Christ in action, even when they can't share it with words, but in action by helping homeless neighbors that you meet on the streets to get a new start with job training, to get a new start, to get a home of their own, to get cleaned up, to be ready to go out and deal with the challenges of the world. Mission 317, when they see the star, I hope they rejoice. In Bridge City Community with my friend Josh Woodrow, a pastor there, seeking to bring spiritual and racial reconciliation, because the kingdom of God isn't segregated and our churches and communities shouldn't be either. To go in where two used to be divided, whites and non-whites, blacks versus whites, and say, no, we're going to come together in Christ. We want to support that and then learn from that how we can then make a difference in our area code as well, so that when people see the star, they would rejoice with exceeding great joy. So John 3:17 again. Remember the area code where he has placed you, and remember the calling that he has given to us. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Jesus. May we be the instruments that God uses to do that. Mission 3:17.